Okay, good evening, everyone. We are on the record. Could I have all of your attention, please? This is a regular meeting of the Jersey City Municipal Council. Today is Wednesday, the 14th day of October in the year 2015. We had a scheduled 6 p.m. start. It's 6:11 p.m. May we have a roll call? First of all, I've taken the liberty of silencing my phone. I hope you'll all do that, please. President, roll call at 6:11 p.m. Councilperson Gajewski.
Here.
Councilperson Ramchal is ill, recovering from a serious illness. He will not be here tonight. Councilman Bajano. Councilman Yun is absent. Councilperson Osborne.
Here.
Coleman.
Here.
Rivera.
Here.
Waterman.
Here.
Lavara.
Here.
We have 7 members in attendance at 6:11 p.m. Would everyone kindly rise to observe a moment of silence?
Mr. Buster Brown, the father of Ms. Florence Holmes, an employee at the Bethune Center.
Ms. Mary Toon, the mother of a former director, Dyrese Toon.
Lucille Maffei, Jersey City resident and grandmother of Joel Maffei.
Carmel Sayas.
Carmela Costanza, the mother of Gina Costanza Martinelli, supervisor of Senior Citizen Outreach.
Her son John is also a Jersey City firefighter. She was one of the most important congregants of St. Joseph's Church in Jersey City. Thank you very much for being standing for a salute to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, a nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much on behalf of the Council President and members of the Council. In accordance with the New Jersey Public Laws of 1975, Chapter 231 of the Open Public Meetings Act, better known as the Sunshine Law. Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided by notifying by mail the local newspapers. Additionally, the annual notice of this meeting was posted on the bulletin board of the first floor of City Hall and filed in the office of the City Clerk on Wednesday, November 26, 2014, indicating the schedule of meetings and caucuses for the Municipal Council for the calendar year 2015. In addition, at the time of its preparation, the agenda of this meeting was similarly disseminated on Thursday, October 8th, 2015, at 4 p.m. to the Mayor, Council, Business Administrator, and the local newspapers, and posted on the city's website so I can certify as to our full and total compliance with the Sunshine Law. Before we go to first reading ordinances, we have just that light housekeeping to add the business that is not on the printed agenda that went out last Thursday.
I'd like to make a motion, Robert, to add our ordinances 3H, 3I, 3J, resolutions 10Z17 through 10Z28.
Second.
The motion is made by Councilperson Rivera. Seconded by Councilperson Osborne. Councilperson Gajewski on the motion.
Aye.
Bajano.
Aye.
Yun is absent. Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara.
Aye.
Okay, we have a full agenda.
Robert, before we proceed, I just want to make a comment because I should have made this a caucus. So there's a lot of late items to the BA Law Department and to the clerk as well. I'll say that there's a lot of late items, and we should make a concerted effort to make sure that we don't have these many late items added to the agenda. Z17 to Z28, was that? 9 items? That's a lot.
11.
Okay, so the next agenda meeting, we're going to crack down. Thanks.
I appreciate
okay,
that.
Okay, permit me, council members, members of the public, to read the titles of first reading ordinances into the record. Item 3A, City Ordinance 15-136. Is an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 8, Permit Parking, and Chapter 160, Fees and Charges of the Jersey City Municipal Code. 3B, City Ordinance 15-137, an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting amendments for the addition of short-term rental use to Chapter 345, Article 1, Definitions, and Article 4, Section 60, Supplementary Zoning. 3C is City Ordinance 15-138, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 3, Administration of Government, Article 3, Mayor, and Article 6, Department of Public Safety of the Jersey City Municipal Code. This affects, actually assigns the Division of Parking Enforcement and Office of Emergency Management and Homeland Security in their proper place in the code. 3D, City Ordinance 15-139. An ordinance authorizing the City of Jersey City to execute a month-to-month lease not to exceed 6 months effective as of December 1, 2015 for 3000 Kennedy Boulevard LLC for the use of 29 parking spaces at 3000 Kennedy Boulevard, Jersey City. 3E, City Ordinance 15-140 is an ordinance supplementing Chapter 332, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 2, Traffic Regulations, amending Section 332-5, One-Way Streets of the Jersey City Code, designating Bay Street from Warren Street to Marin Boulevard as a one-way west and repealing the one-way west on 2nd Street from Washington Street to Marin Boulevard. 3F is City Ordinance 15-141. It's an ordinance supplementing Chapter A, 351, Executive Orders and Ordinances of the Jersey City Code to create a new classified position for Chief Project Coordinator Construction. 3G, City Ordinance 15-142 is an ordinance supplementing A-351, Executive Orders and Ordinances of the Jersey City Code to create a new classified position for Road Inspector. 3H is City Ordinance 15-143, an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting amendments to the Powerhouse Arts Redevelopment Plan Rehabilitation Subdistrict to accommodate the adapted reuse of the Historic Merchants Refrigerator Company building for self-storage and first-floor commercial space, which property is located at 133 2nd Street and designated as Block 11502, Lot 1, on the tax map of the City of Jersey City. 3I is Ordinance 15-144. It's an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City adopting the Scatter Site Redevelopment Plan. 3J is City Ordinance 15-145. An ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 4, Paid Sick Time of the Jersey City Municipal Code. So, council members, we're voting for the introduction on first reading of items 3A through 3J. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye for introduction.
Baggiano.
I just want to say something about 3B. I'm speaking to the state rooming house director today, and I want to let the people know, if you rent one room out, you're not subject to any of the state laws. If you rent more than one room out, you are subject to the rooming house laws. Now, the other night, we were told by the Corporation Council, unless I misunderstood them, that they can rent out up to five before they become subject to the state laws. Not so. It's more than one, you become subject to the state laws. Also, I spoke to a person that has a rooming house. The average insurance is $6,000 for her rooming house. If you go on today's laptop, you'll read a whole list of problems with renting out rooms by homeowners. And then fourth, the homeowner's insurance that people have, and most insurances, will not cover you for any liability or damage to your property or anything. I vote no on B. Yes, I'll go along with the rest.
Councilperson Osborne?
Aye for introduction.
Holman?
Aye for introduction.
Rivera?
Aye for introduction.
Waterman?
Aye for introduction.
Lavara?
Aye for introduction.
3A, 7-0, 3B, 6-1, Councilman Bargiano, no, 3C through 3J, 7-0. Thank you, council members. Item 4A, City Ordinance 15-132.
What is that one, Danny?
It's an ordinance of the Municipal Council of the City of Jersey City, adopting amendments for the addition of an art gallery use to Chapter 345, Article 1, Definitions, and Article 5, Section 60, Supplementary Zoning. This is a public hearing on the ordinance. Are there any members of the public wishing to be heard?
Motion.
Second.
We have a motion by the Council President. Seconded by Councilperson Osborne.
Balked it, no. Thanks, Joyce.
To close the public hearing, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Bargiano.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Council President.
Aye.
We have a 7-0 vote for the close of the public hearing. For final adoption of item 4A, City Ordinance 15-132. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Bargiano.
Aye.
Yun is absent. Osborne.
Aye.
So that would have
been Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Council Prez.
Aye.
7-0 vote for the final adoption of item 4A, City Ordinance 15-132. Council members, members of the public, items 4B and 4C were just moments ago introduced as new items for the council's consideration. They'll be advertised for a public hearing in 2 weeks at the meeting of the 28th. Could I have a motion to table?
Wait, we're going to make a motion to we're just going to defeat 4B, right? We're just going to defeat this. Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to defeat
okay.
B.
All right.
Second.
No, we don't need a motion.
Okay.
No need.
Just vote to.
We're going to defeat. We're going right to the defeat of item 4B, City Ordinance 134. And we're going to defeat this ordinance. Councilperson Gajewski?
No.
What do we?
No.
Yeah.
No.
Councilman Bargiano?
Yes. No.
Defeating this ordinance, thank you. Councilperson Osborne?
No.
Coleman?
No.
Rivera?
No.
Waterman? Council President.
And just so people understand, there's a modified version introduced as first reading and will be taken up at the next meeting. I vote no.
It's been defeated 0-7, absent council members Ramchal and Yun. Now, can I have a motion to table item 4C? City Ordinance 15-135 prior to the close of the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion by Councilperson Waterman, seconded by Councilperson Osborne. Table, Councilperson Gajewski?
Aye.
Bargiano?
Aye.
Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera?
Aye.
Waterman?
Aye.
Lavaro?
Aye.
We have a 7-0 vote to table.
Okay, we're gonna...
Prior to the close of the public hearing, item 4C, City Ordinance 15-135. Council members, we're to the speakers.
No, wait, we're removing from the tabled agenda?
We'll do that after the speakers.
After the speakers, okay.
Speakers, in case anyone touches on that, that's... wants to touch on that during their time. Public request for hearing, Laverne Washington. We don't have much of a crowd tonight, so if your name is, if you're coming close to being to speak, just migrate up to the batter's box up in the front, okay? Thank you.
Good evening again.
Good evening.
I have a very serious problem. This past week, well, since school started, I live on Randolph, right close to Communipaw Avenue, and the traffic. It has become awesome. And I take a little boy to school in the morning up to, I take him home so his mother can take him to number 12. It's horrible trying to come out of my block to get up to Bramhall Avenue. And then coming back home, it took me 20 minutes this morning to come down Randolph from Bramhall to where I live on Communipaw. Garfield was terrible. Randolph from Claremont all the way out, Grand Street, Ocean into Grand. I don't know how MLK or Bergen was, but it's been like this since school came back. I don't know what's going on, but I think we need to do a traffic study. I mean, and I sat on my porch when I came back this morning. That traffic was backed up to 10 o'clock this morning. 10 o'clock. Normally you get kind of heavy traffic in the morning, but by 8:39 o'clock, it has let up. I mean, 10 o'clock this morning. And it's been bad, and you got, you know, kids trying to cross to go to school. It's horrible. And then my other thing is, we have to do something about our young people. They standing around on our corners, and they smoke their herb, they talk loud, and they're becoming very disrespectful. I had an altercation here lately, one time too many. And I demand respect. I give respect, and I demand respect. This is my community. I lived on my block where I lived for 30 years. I run a block association around here. I have an after-school program that I take kids to a Heavenly Temple from 3 to 6:30. My kids are there now. I got somebody bringing them home for me today. And it's horrible. I'm sitting there waiting on them to come out of school, and I got to tell people to take a walk. Because I don't want my kids smelling weed. Or I don't want them seeing somebody selling. Bad enough I had got rid of the alcoholics. I pushed them to the little circle across the street. But this is insane. The cursing, kids coming out of school, and we got to tolerate this. This is horrible. The cops was out there on the junction, you know, but nobody comes in the block. And I think with so many schools, and I live in the intersection, and Communipaw and the junction is the middle of Jersey City. And you know, this is a disgrace. You got Lincoln High School up the street, you're going down to 22 school, 12 school, 14 school, the kids in that area. And I don't think that you have to tolerate this stuff. People cussing and carrying on. When do we say enough is enough? I had a little girl went to school and called her teacher the B word and the F word because this is what she hear. Going to school with people out there on our sidewalks and standing in front of the bodegas and wherever. But I just want to bring this to your attention, and I try my best. Like back here in September, I got 700 school shirts and 700 t-shirts. I gave out over close to 600 already to school 14, 12, 15, 34, number 4 down here, 22. And now, Mr. Rivera, he's going to help me with some pants, hopefully this week, for the children. And next month, I'll be doing my coat drive. You know, every year, for going on 15 years, like these kids in the community, from the Jones Square Heights to Greenville, all over the city, I give out over 200 brand-new coats. And I try my best. But But I can't do it by myself. I'm one person. You know, so I hope this council would look into it and help us out. Thank you, and have a blessed day. I'm finished.
Laverne.
Yes, ma'am.
I'd just like to let you know that there's a whole bunch of stuff going on in Jersey City right now. They're going to close Pavonia Avenue. There was a water main break in Hoboken, and they're paving Pacific Avenue, which is one of the main,
yeah, I know that. My sister's
one of
blocked.
The main mm-hmm. ways to get to Grand Street or go down, you know, so... It took me an hour to do a 10-minute ride this morning, but hopefully that's to make a better ride, and it'll
right.
be over in a few minutes.
But I know
hopefully.
Before, Councilman, not cutting you off, but before they started working on Ms. Tiffin, it was the same way. It just got a little worse because they can't cut,
yeah.
you know, off of Garfield the back way and come up Pacific.
Yeah.
That made it double heavy. Yeah. But it needs to be looked into. It really do. Thank you.
Thank you, Laverne.
Next speaker is Samuel Gutierrez.
Not here.
Steve Hyman.
He's here.
Yes, he is. Let's go. You're up, Steve.
Steve.
Council members, I'm here again. I hope that we can get some sense out of what's happening. And I understand from my lawyer's perspective that you submitted something that is an error. And I'll let him talk to you if he wants to. I came here today. I was late because I was visiting with Chico. He's doesn't look very good. He's ill, and yet he wanted to come here for the meeting, but his doctor told him he shouldn't do that, and I think that that's the right thing to do. I feel very much taken by what's been going on in all the years in Jersey City. The mayor doesn't want me to develop the property. On the other hand, everywhere around him that you look, there's development. There's development right across the street from me. Bed Bath & Beyond Pep Boys and BJ's and ShopRite. They get a pass. I mean, they're... People say, you know, you're not from this town. Well, they're not from this town either. And the truth of the matter is that their property and my property are the same kind of property, unfortunately. And what I mean by that is that neither of them were properly abandoned by Jersey City and Conrail. It's not abandoned property. I was going to come here and fight the fight, but it's pointless. We hear the city council vote without good reason, and I own the property. Excuse me, my wife owns the property. She bought it in 2005. From Conrail. Jersey City refused to bid on purchasing it, and no sooner do I become the owner of the property in 2005 that they run to the Surface Transportation Board in D.C. Now, doing that, it limits the realities of this project. Doing that costs this council and prior councils it's over $150 million by not letting this property be developed. Instead, the mayor claims that he wants a park there. It would be one of the most ludicrous things that could happen. Nobody wants a park up on that wall, except the people that live right around it. It doesn't do any good for any of you that live in Jersey City, but it's bad because you're not getting any money out of it. On a yearly basis, if you could build what we had suggested, it would be $13 million a year. Cumulatively, it's over $150 million. And that money could go better to a lot of uses. The schools, the police. I heard Diane say that there's a lot of broken pipes and water main leaks. Well, why is that happening? Because Jersey City can't afford to take care of them. I'm proposing, and I have been proposing, to develop this property and provide that money to Jersey City in form of pilot. And if you or the mayor wanted something better than what status quo is, tell me about it. We can do almost anything because we own the property. My wife owns the property. Thank you.
Yolanda Dean.
Everyone ready? I'm the all listening ears.
You're Yolanda?
Yes, I am.
Begin.
Hi, my name is Yolanda Dean. I'm a resident of Wegman Court, which is a dead-end block, and I'm speaking in behalf of my fellow neighbors in regards to a situation that has occurred over the last 4 months. A fence was put up based on a court order, and no one seems to know anything about this court order. No one can produce it, and we have yet seen a court order. This fence has been put up illegally. There's no legal court order, as I mentioned, no documentation that stipulates the construction of a fence across the street that blocks and keeps us from making a U-turn. Okay. Again, there's no fence like this on any other street in the neighborhood or anywhere else that I know of in Jersey City. The only record for this street, the owner who said he was authorized to put this fence up, that page has been ripped from the records. That's missing from the city records. This fence is also a liability, which means it's a fire hazard. I've contacted former Captain Moody, who's a fire chief, who used to be a fire chief within Jersey City. That's a fire hazard. And on top of that, there's a fire pump that do not produce any water. So now, with this fence being up, if there was a bushfire behind the fence, the fire department would not have access to put it out. If there was a fire in the house next to the fence, the fire department will have difficulty accessing the side of the house. Number two, this fence is a safety hazard, okay? It do not provide any, it's one way in and one way out, which means if you come in, more than likely you will have to back out. There has been numerous occasions where this fence has caused a traffic jam. Okay, I have contacted Vivian, the deputy mayor, Ms. Vivian Bradley. She knows me very well. I am an accredited family child care provider. I have clients coming in and out, and now it is affecting my livelihood. Okay, because again, this fence has been put up illegally. And what's more important, that so many city officials have come down to do a drive-by, taking pictures. Oh, we're gonna take the fence down. This should not be. And it's just a false hope, and it's a temporary solution. Okay, we're looking at snow removal. When the snow hits, like we had in the several past years, a lot of snow, there's no way to begin in the beginning to put the snow. Now with this fence, everything is gonna be pushed up against the fence, and it's gonna prohibit any more in and out traffic. Okay? And I've been on this block for about 12 years. My fellow neighbors will express they've been here over 30, 40 years, and there's a lot of elderly people that live on the block. So that's why it's a small group right here to speak in behalf of Wegman Court, because they put up with this nonsense for so many years. And taking the lead to try to get some solution, it has come to me to stand before a podium to have my voice heard. And I think it's a crying shame, okay? And on top of that, after the fence was put up, improper signage was put up, okay? No recollection. We had Mr. McCann, I will start dropping names, came down and said, no one from the city authorized this signage. We already know entering the dead-end block, there's a sign that says dead-end. Now we got three signs posted, dead-end, dead-end, dead-end. We can all read. We know. It's causing a deterioration to the neighborhood, to the block, by having these additional signages that serve no purpose. And on top of that, they took away 25 additional feet. So now we have less parking, less means of turning around. We need an egress, okay? All the residents of Wegman Court, with the exception of one, who's the cause of this problem, okay, who got everyone in City Hall fooled, okay, that he is the owner of this property. And coincidental, yesterday, one of the other owners cut it down. He has no problem with the residents making this U-turn. Okay? So I would like for this situation to be resolved sooner than later, because it's going to get cold, it's getting daylight savings, it's about to end, and it's going to cause a problem. And if there's a serious accident, who's going to be accountable? So I just want to make mention that I'm here taking time out of my busy schedule because I live there and I'm a taxpayer. And I would like this situation resolved sooner than later. Thank you.
Okay. I'm just going to take a minute to respond, Ms. Dean. Are there several people from the neighborhood about this? Okay. So let me respond, and then maybe it can save you the grief and anxiety about this. So
okay.
I'm just going to rewind very. This goes back several weeks, I guess, maybe a month. Just to be clear, I did not initiate putting up the fence over at the end of Wegman Court. I say that to say that. The individual, I'm not going to name names because it's a public, it's being videotaped and all this, but the individual who did erect the fence came to my office, was issued tickets by the city, and he produced the tickets and he showed it to me and he asked me to address the matter so that he didn't get ticketed. I told him, I looked up the violations that he was issued for, since you dropped his name already, I'll mention his name. Mr. McCann issued those tickets to that individual, and those tickets said that he was fined for not having a fence on a vacant lot and around the properties he owns. Looked up the ordinance that it was pertaining to, and Mr. McCann was correct. There's an ordinance on the books for vacant lots that they have to be enclosed by a fence. So I told him, all I said to him was, I can't help you. The violations are legal on their face. You have to deal with those violations in court. You either comply with the violations or you and address it, or you have to deal with it in court. I assume he dealt with it by erecting the fence, which I know because I went down there and visited it myself. So after that, subsequently after that, in erecting the fence, he came to the city council again because he wanted the area curbed off and so forth, and to not allow for parking because it's a dead end on his properties and so forth, and to the back end there. So we directed him to the Department of Public Works to address that. So the signage that was erected with regard to dead end and so forth, the Department of Public Works erected that, as far as I know, and they did that thinking it was proper and appropriate. The rest of these council members, Councilperson Coleman, Councilman Waterman, Rivera, myself, we've all been there. We agree with you and concur with you 100%. It's a mess down there. And as you said, it's one car gets in there and you can't get out. You're stalled. So our resident response center has been working with the law department to figure out how to address it, and they haven't removed the fence because it's private property at this point, and so they're concerned that they might be violating, that the city may be liable for taking away someone's private property in that regard. So I will say this, and I'll confer with my council colleagues on this. We will immediately speak to the law department and public safety about this, particularly fire and so forth, to look at that matter and to see if on the grounds of some sort of public safety nuisance and so forth, that fence can be removed, and to order that person to remove the fence in that regard. After that, the law department is still trying to figure out, working with the resident response center and public works, what the long-term solution is there. So I sympathize with all of you. I know that we've been down there. It is a mess. You're absolutely 100% right. And we can't move fast enough to get this done. I give you my word, we will stay on top of it every single day to see that you get some relief over there.
And also, there's another issue, Rolando, that the owner complied and paid the tickets. And yeah. if we change that now, then somebody owes him for the tickets and for putting the fence up and for taking it down, which means he complied with the ordinance and he paid the tickets. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. So Joanne, if we can get the law department to look at this, they're already looking at it, but obviously it needs to be looked at quicker. Like some resolution is needed there so that they can have some relief.
That was an excellent summary of the history of the transaction there. I can tell you that we have been in touch with Arthur Glattman, who's the attorney for the property owner. He has promised to supply us with a survey of the property so that we can then have engineering confirm that the fence is within the property line. If it is within the property line and engineering or anyone else concludes that there is a public reason, a public necessity to move that fence back, we would try to negotiate that with the owner. Worst case scenario, if it really becomes a safety issue, then the city would have to acquire that property.
So I'm going to ask if we can investigate it and determine whether there's a public safety issue and whether or not we can take action on some public safety grounds.
Right. We're trying to do both, but we thought that the best place to start was the survey, which the owner claims to have. If we don't get the survey by the end of this week, we may have to undertake our own survey.
Joanne, if this has been going on for 4 months, we're going to have the city investigate now. This should have been taken care of 3 months ago. One way.
I don't know exactly why it's taken this long. It probably bounced around a couple of different agencies. All I can tell you is it came to the law department last week, and we are on it as best we can. We are dealing with the attorney.
If there's a fire there and somebody gets killed, who's going to be responsible? The city?
Well, if there's a fire there, they're going to take that fence down, okay? So that is really, if it was a true emergency, it's not a brick wall they've built. It's chain link fence. So,
but there's an elderly sick lady down there that can't get in and out right now. In other words, she can't get out to get medical treatment. The ambulance can't get in. In other words, we need to do something yesterday, because if this lady passes away in there because she couldn't get medical treatment, the city could be involved in that situation somehow or another. That's why I'm asking.
I mean,
you.
The only way that could I mean, we could never concede that kind of liability anyway, but I mean, if unless it's obstructing the existing public right of way, I don't see what it has to do with the city. The property owner was told to erect the fence. He was given tickets and compelled to erect the fence, actually. He was being fined if he didn't. So whether he did it properly or whether he did it within his property lines, whether he's now encroaching on the public right-of-way or whether we have to reconfigure the right-of-way, I mean, it's not that complicated, and we are on it, unfortunately, only as of last week. It's a resolvable problem. So
It seems like at a time like this, when it's something that can cause this kind of a problem, we should be able to amend the law, the ordinance, to make it suit this emergency area. In other words, it doesn't have to mean all areas are treated that way, but because this particular area creates this kind of a problem, I think it would be considered an emergency. Like when we amend ordinance to increase the height of a building, we should amend the ordinance to determine whether this gentleman needs to put a fence there or not. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I absolutely do, but we have to respect private property rights as well. It is a balancing always. If there's a true emergency, they're going to take the fence down. Absent that, we are going to try to resolve it as quickly as possible in a constitutional and legal way that doesn't bring additional liability to the city.
So the only concern that I have really is that, again, I did go by down the block. So you know, that block, gets, I thought Patterson Street was the most narrowest block, but Wegman Court is even more narrower than Patterson Street. But they have a double whammy there with the width of that block, because it's very dangerous. And then there is no working fire hydrant there, like people are expressing. So they have that.
There's no working fire hydrant?
There's one, and where it is, it's not working.
So, well, that's a fire department issue.
My point is that there's
so you'll get an opportunity to come up in a minute.
Problem.
Pardon?
I said, no, I'm telling the gentleman he'll have an opportunity. Are you on the list? Okay. Just give us a second. We're going to work through this, try to work through this before you come up.
Yeah, and I just want to reiterate what Councilwoman Coleman said. If there's anywhere we could, like, expedite something like that, because it's a dangerous situation.
I mean, if you eliminated parking on one side of the street, would that help the turnaround?
No. So Joanne, can our law department speak to the property owner and his lawyer and ask him if he will voluntarily remove it? And could our city, Public Works, because it would be an expense to him since we initiated this with the ticketing, around that, could our Public Works maybe save him the expense by removing it
for now
to provide these folks some relief? You have to see
have
the area.
I've already sent a very similar letter to the attorney along those very lines, but I don't, you know, I haven't heard back from him, so I don't want to say, I didn't even want to say that much because I don't know what his response will be. But that is that's a very good idea, seeing that it's the same one as the law department came up with, especially. But no, okay. It is a good idea.
I'm going to tell the folks out there. So I know the property owner. Again, I won't say his name. I will personally give him a call tonight after this meeting is done and ask him if he can have his fence removed and with the BAs. And if he's concerned about the costs, I'm going to suggest then maybe after consulting with you, whether the Public Works can remove it for him so as to get this
and then
taken care of.
It
if there's some legal,
you know, if you, if
yeah.
You, in
but
other
you know
words,
what? No fence should go back here, period.
But he's going to get fined and ticketed.
Well, we shouldn't fine him. That's,
if you put any fence there, the space is too small. We
should be looking for a solution.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Fence.
But we did send a letter to his lawyer, Arthur Glattman, who used to be an attorney in the law department many years ago. He's a very practical, smart guy. I think he sees what needs to be done, and I feel like we can work with him. But it's not a guarantee, and if the owner doesn't want to do it, I mean, we're going to have to consider Plan B.
I will speak to the owner.
Yeah, okay, but that offer is already out there.
Okay, so for the folks who are out there, after this meeting's over, I'll give the gentleman a call. I'll impress upon him the importance of asking him to be a good Samaritan and remove the fence for the sake of everyone, yourselves and the city. And if
people are here on the speaker's list,
and we won't give them any tickets.
To speak about this tonight, raise your hand. If you're not on the list, you're not speaking. Who's on the list and is here to speak on this tonight?
Okay.
All right, the council has a good idea then.
And the other thing with the fire hydrant, why don't one of you or two of you pick up the phone tomorrow morning, because I know we will, and call 547-4239, the public safety office. Tell them the fire hydrant's been out for quite a while. Get the damn thing fixed, and they should fix it right away. That's unbelievable.
We I don't know if we want repair.
Next speaker, council members, members
yeah.
of the public.
Actually, if I could just add one more thing. Margaret, all those individuals, if you raise your hand, if you approach her and give her your contact information, we will stay in communication with you throughout this process and see that we get this resolved to your satisfaction.
So who are the people?
What's that? Yeah.
Margaret
will take your names. And so I'm just going to ask, you certainly have every right to speak if you're on the list. I want you to know we've heard you and we get it, and we're going to move as expeditiously as possible. And if you don't need to speak at this point, would ask you to forfeit that, I guess. But that's your choice, and you have every right to speak as well. And Margaret will take your contact information as well, and she'll share it with all the council people. Okay.
Next speaker on the list is Karen Cody. Are you Karen Cody?
Yes, I'm Nathan Cody.
No, you sorry?
I'm Nathan Cody. My sister let
you're number 24.
Yes, my sister let me go on my spot if you don't mind.
That doesn't happen.
What do you mean it doesn't happen? My sister can't let me go on her spot. Why not?
It doesn't happen.
I'm on the list.
It doesn't happen.
But it needs to happen because right, we're missing something very important.
Hold on, folks. Let's just, Mr.
But do that really matter though, 22 or 24? Do that really matter, sir? My sister says it's okay. It doesn't matter. Because we're missing a real point here.
Nathan, you have to wait, Nathan.
Karen Cody.
Yes.
Thank you, Karen.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you doing?
All right, good. My name is Karen, and I've been on Wegman Court for 37, almost 40 years. As a resident and a homeowner. I know my neighbor just spoke about all the things that's going on in our block, but I'm here to say my mother is 84 years old that lives with me and been a resident on that block almost 40 years. A mother of 12, that's my pride and joy. Nobody can get down there for our neighbors. Not just my mother, Mr. Vaughn, we got Ms. Crutcher, we got Ms. Waiters, we got a young man that grew up with me, Jason. Everybody's doing something for us right now. This fence been up since July. I've been calling, begging. Nobody's been assisting us. Far as that's our mother, my neighbors, who I grew up with. Emergency occur, what we say? Wait, Ma. They say, wait, it's coming. Just like that fire hydrant, no water, that gate went up. I went to work. For 37 years, I lived in that. I went to work, and I came home, and I ran smack into a fence. Nobody can do for us. It's not right. Not in this time of day, this year, that we would ever think that we could get treated this way. We're the people. Are we people? We're the people. We're part of the people. We may not be in the right neighborhood which y'all want us to be or whatever, but we're people. We deserve to have this, the right to be treated. We're taxpayers. We're hardworking people. We come home. I got to say, I got to walk you up the street because I can't get down the street. It only takes one or two cars to come. We're done. While they figuring out in the street those two cars, all of a sudden, Jason needs an ambulance or something. We hit. So while we waiting to something to happen, something so crucial to happen to one of us before everybody say, let's do something. I understand he owns that property and they put that fence up. But if y'all really looked at that property, for 37 years we've been driving this. We bought our homes under false pretense because we knew we had a turning point. And now you're going to say, this is the only block in Jersey City that we don't know what happened to it. There's no turning point in this block. We own, we pay taxes for the street, right? We own that. But it's a public right of way because I can't park in the middle of the street when I come home. Why can't y'all buy that land back and make that a public right of way? Why are we waiting? Because we need that because of the fact that if y'all see that fence, that smack up right there, we have no place to go. Fire, emergency, snow, we can't get in. We can't get in. And the lot is on the side. So why wouldn't you fence the side? You fence the street. If you really look at it, it says that you have to have a fence on a vacant lot. The lot is on the side. This lot is on this side, and the lot is on this side. That's a paved road. That's a street. We had garages there that we rolled over the cliff. That was always a street. So we brought our houses. Now y'all telling us, oh, you don't have a turning point. Something has to be done. Why are we waiting? Why are we waiting for things to happen? Why do we have to let something happen to one of our neighbors, our mothers, our fathers? We pay taxes just like everybody else. Everybody's sitting up here looking, and it's time to do it now. It's getting done, but this fence went up in July. And the story to that neighbor getting that ticket, let me tell you, he owns a very old truck. And let me tell you what he did with that truck. He pulled that truck out and he blocked everybody one day. My mother was going for therapy and her van came down the block and it's on record. And that van had an accident. That's why Jerry McCann came in and got that man and he got a ticket. It's not all because he had no fence. Because his son has cars up there. He uses for the used cars lot. He has an old truck that he uses up there. So it's not, y'all not hearing the truth. It's not because what y'all say, he got the ticket. My mother had to walk down the street the rest of her therapy because that truck could not come back down the street and turn. That's why Jerry McCann ticketed him. Because if you go down, you see the truck is parked in his driveway. That truck's so old, he don't even use it. Now it's blocking his driveway. And that truck been there for years, like 20 years he had it sitting there. And I thank y'all, and I wish y'all all would try to help us.
Jason Dabney. Jason Dabney.
He's coming.
Not as fast as I used to, but I'm coming.
Take your time, sir.
Good evening to everybody. About this gate, there's two gates that's going on over there. As you can tell, I can't sit and get my medical transport. I've used county of Hudson County transport. I use Olympic transport, VIP transport, and they're all telling me to get and meet them at the corner. I can barely be able to walk. As far as them with this gate, everybody's telling me that they can't go down the block and go turn around. I remember it was one time that I actually called the ambulance for me. The ambulance told me to sit there and come to the corner. I told them I can't move. They actually took the bedding up out of the ambulance and actually wheeled it to my house and wheeled me from the house all the way to Garfield. Doesn't make any, like I said, I've been there for all my life. You're talking about, I'm 38. I've actually been up on the block. You're talking about 36 years. And that has never been like that. You're talking about all the blocks around Freedom, Skyline. None of these blocks has this particular problem. But We have the problem. And I've been waiting to sit and come up in here and sit and say the name that you don't want to sit and mention. I also, it's everything up in me to sit in and actually name his name. But I'm not. Like I said, we can't do this. The street sweeper winds up backing down the block because he can't turn around no more. You're talking about actually seeing an ambulance go down the block forward and actually back all the way up to Garfield, which makes no sense at all. Yes, just like you said, the block is skinny. Yes, it's real tight. Ain't no need to sit in and actually not be able to turn around down there. And like I said, I've had all of this time on this block, and I have never had a problem up in the block. Never. And now all of a sudden I'm having lots of problems up in the block. I just, like I said, this, if you ask me, the fence is actually painted a behind rather than it being one of them guardrails that goes along the back fence, the way all of these other blocks are looking like, the way that I believe it's supposed to be. We have a second fence, which is, if you ask me, is that's the problem of the block being able to do what it is they have to sit in and do. And just like you said, you're talking about I've been up on the block for this long. The fire hydrant doesn't even work. The one and only fire hydrant that's there. It's kind of sad. I'm understanding that you guys are working. I understand that you guys have heard the cry before. But I'm saying, and I'm finished, please, 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 please don't sit and forget about what it is that you're actually hearing. Like I said, I'm medical. I can't even get medical transport. You're talking about I seen an ambulance have to send it back up the block. You're talking about the fire hydrant that's there doesn't even work.
Mason, the fire hydrant will be taken care of.
Thank you, sir.
People will be notified in the morning.
Well, thank you.
Actually, in about 10 minutes through a text to somebody.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. You guys have a good one.
Karen DeSoto. Yvonne Balser.
Mr. Byrne, Daniel Mr. Siscardi wants to know if he's on the list.
No.
He's not on your list?
Oh, yes, he is. If he looked at the agenda, he's 21.
No, he doesn't go up to 20. It goes to 20 on the front.
My office, we print.
Okay.
Print the list, and then
people
run. He's number 21.
Okay, Yvonne Balser. I just want to speak about what happened in court yesterday. I just want to know that, from my point of view, it was when the judge ruled that Jersey City must have a runoff. That kind of got lost in the newspaper. That was the reason for the lawsuit. So we must have a loss. We must have a runoff if we do not meet that threshold that we normally have. So I guess if the people decided to move to November, we still will have to have a runoff. That's, the judge said that. So that's the reason for the lawsuit. Now, the other issue I want to bring up is that I have a neighbor of mine who called me and asked me, Yvonne, is the reval on? She had someone knock on her door and wanted to enter. And she figured I would know this. So I'm asking the city government. So that was probably a scam then, huh? So what's the status right now of the reval? Are we still in court or what? It's still in litigation? I know they were in litigation in February, and here it is October, so we're still in litigation, huh? Where we will be at? I would love to attend, so if you know, I'll email you. I'd like to attend with a, okay. So I guess you should let the public know that there are people knocking on people's door and say that they are from the reval company. Please let us in. Because the ladies did call me, so something to be aware of. The other issue I want to bring up is the city bikes. I'm not for or against city bikes. What concerns me is parking. I notice how many parking spaces are being used, being taken up when they're in the curb area. Do anyone know how many parking spaces have been lost by having them on the sidewalk is one thing, but having them in a city where there is no parking at all, and you're taking up maybe two or three or four parking spaces, that's a lot. How many spaces are we losing? I mean, I know, and you yourself know this, how many times have people come here and talked about we need zone parking because we can't find parking in our neighborhood like Ward B, and all of a sudden you're having the city put in city bikes, you know, where people park their cars at. That's absolutely ridiculous, and it's unwarranted in a city that doesn't have municipal parking garages as they should have. So I'm asking the city, could you please tell me how many parking spaces have we lost? That's totally unfair.
We don't have that answer.
You don't have it? Well, when they put it in there, did they know where they put it at? Could I have a list where they're at? Because I think it's absolutely wrong. I really do. I mean,
it's posted online.
It's posted online, all that. Yeah, it's wrong to do this without the input of the public to use that. Because people really literally fight over parking. I saw that when I was living downtown in Van Buys Park. I saw people actually fight over parking. So, basically, that's it. Thank you very much.
Wayne Baskerville. Sonia Vasquez. So Ms. Vasquez at the beginning of the meeting. Okay. If I could just ask anyone, if your name is on the speaker's list, you know we're getting close to you, migrate up towards the front. Be ready to speak.
Sonia Vasquez?
Coming.
Okay.
Ms. Vasquez?
Hello. First time I'm here. This is regarding parking at Clifton Place and near the old Margaret Hayes. We're having issues with parking. My mom is a homeowner there, and we have people that are homeowners and do rent from those houses. Now, these people have their own private parking. Right now, we have people parking illegally. I don't know who Ms. Coleman is. I have sent her an email with pictures. I even called her assistant. I haven't gotten no calls back with this issue.
I'm gonna go get her right now.
Okay.
Hold on.
Oh, you're Ms. Coleman. Hello. Okay.
What's your street, Ms. Vasquez?
It's Clifton Place by the Beacon. These people are a gated community. They have their own private parking, and they refuse to pay their own parking. So now we're having an issue parking at nighttime. They put up the sign from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Zone 2. We're not worried about the morning parking. We're worried about night and weekends because technically is overcrowded there. I've taken pictures. I have people parking in driveways, blocking homeowners that are trying to leave. Emergency vehicles cannot pass through there when there's cars parked on the side where they're making turns. I even have pictures of cars trying to get through and they can't.
Ms. Vasquez, do you want to extend Zone 2 beyond 5 p.m.?
We want Clifton resident parking only, and visitors also for our visitors, not the Beacon.
Okay, so there's a procedure.
There's four buildings on Clifton Place that are facing Clifton Place, and right now I went to Parking Authority and I seen a few cars of people that lived on Beacon that are getting to Zone 2 parking. So we don't want that for them. We want it for us because we are homeowners and we rent from that area. So
Diane,
I'm hoping that you guys do something.
Yeah.
I just told her to talk to you right now, and there's a process for that. She's going to walk you through it so that we can submit the right paperwork to request residential.
I got apartment. The petition done. We have 60. They told me 50 signature. We got 60-something signatures.
You're ahead of the game.
All right, speak to her. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Sylvia Minor.
Before I start,
started already.
I just wanted to be sure. I didn't start. There's still time there.
No.
Wait, the council members have not seen our block? Because I have pictures if you need to see it.
I'll give them to me. Go back and start. Time is to give them all to me. That you want.
Okay. Well, I'm here from Wegman Court. And I'm going to start basically about the garages that used to be in the back of the block and where the fence, the first fence starts, as you can see on all of the pictures. Erosion has set in, which no one has taken into fact that has transpired. When erosion sets in, you lose your property. Part of that property went down the block. I can't imagine that Jersey City would have sold part of our street as someone's property. So what they're doing is they're measuring from where it eroded to the middle of the block. And in respect to when you said you would have our neighbor take the fence down, he'll take the fence down, but he'll go and put his truck right in the middle of it so that nobody can go any further. Now, as far as safety is concerned, I have 3 college students. I have 3 minivans. My girls are whipping U-turns in the middle of Garfield Avenue because they can't turn around on our block when everyone is home in the evening. I lost 1 child in a car accident. I'm not ready to lose another one. Now, as far as that being a situation, I try to leave my driveway open so that my girls can get into our block in the evening. And what's happening is other people are coming down our block and they're making U-turns, and what they're doing, because it's so tight, they're using our driveway. It's not really a U-turn, it's sort of a K-turn. So I have 2 vans that have dents in it. Now, I don't care about having a dented van. I care about having my children alive. So that's very important to me. So also, as a homeowner, I have to maintain a curb in front of my home for 10 to 15 feet. When Hurricane Sandy hit and the tree went down on in front of my house that the city put there, I had to go and fix the sidewalk. Now, how is it that someone could put up a fence and take about 20 or 30 feet away from us and there's no sidewalk? There's no area for us to be able to walk. But anybody else from the block could come down and walk in front of our homes. So that's where I have a problem. As far as snow, you guys can see how far that gate is out. Where the heck is the snow going to go? We already have difficulties with ice and everyone coming in and out of the block. But I can only imagine just how difficult it is going to be to be able to get in and out of our block with that. I just have a few other things that I wanted to talk about. And it's basically, you know, what are we going to do about it? And like someone had said, we need to take that land back if that is so. But honestly, I don't think Jersey City would sell the middle of the street to someone. I don't think that they took erosion into fact. If you look at the diagram that I gave you guys, where the second set of red triangles are, that's where the garages started. And when the garages were there, there were driveways there that you can also use in addition to. So we are really in a bad situation. So I really hope that yesterday you can get in touch with your client and let him know. It's not just one or two of us, it's all of us. And when I bought my house, I was able to turn around. I wouldn't have bought a second van. I would have got myself a little tiny car if That's what I knew I had to deal with, but I wouldn't have even bought the house. That's all I have to say.
Matthew Kopko.
Speaker is Matthew Kopko.
Thank you, Council. My name is Matthew Kopko. I am not here today to speak about the Airbnb situation, but let's just start there quickly. So I've read the proposed ordinance, and I see that the City Council and the new Corporation Council have figured out how to alter the zoning code when they feel like it. I seem to remember some complexity of altering the zoning code being an impediment to putting serious protections in place after the secret deals Jim McGreevy tried to put in at Secret Heart. You guys seem more than capable of altering the zoning code when it comes to real estate related issues. Is there any reason why the zoning code modifications are appropriate here, but not to save the residents who have to live with reentry centers left, right, and everywhere they look? Anybody? Okay.
It's your time. First, take your time.
I'd like to talk today about the 95-story casino being planned in secret in Liberty State Park. It was put to the voters by referendum, and that did not come to pass. Yet special interests do not stop or respect democracy. This is a bipartisan tragedy. People lambast the Christie administration for putting Liberty State Park at risk, but you know who else is secretly backing this plan? Jersey City Mayor Stephen Fulop. Fulop is trying to build a casino that he calls, quote, the highest grossing in North America, bigger than any Las Vegas casino, end quote. He boasts, quote, there's only one place that every major casino operator in the country has come to check out, and that's Jersey City, end quote, as if this is something to be proud of. Has anyone been down to Atlantic City recently? This is our plan to rejuvenate New Jersey's economy, to build Atlantic City 2.0 out here? Do people realize that the casinos there are going bankrupt and being sold for pennies on the dollar? Do people realize that the addiction to casino gambling revenues have caused property taxes in Atlantic City to nearly double in just a few short years? I ask this council, do you support a 95-story casino off the south end of Liberty State Park? Will you actually stand up to the mayor and let him know that you will do anything in your power to prevent it? Why don't we focus on quality jobs? I've released a jobs plan to reboot New Jersey's economy, the only assembly candidate who has, by the way, and I say we need magnets, not casinos, instead of a 95-story monstrosity that will be sold off the moment it's finished and run into the ground. We should do two things. One, we need a top-notch research facility right here focused on logistics, infrastructure, and robotics. I've proposed working with Princeton, NYU, and other leading institutions to build an engineering-focused satellite campus on the south end of Liberty State Park. We need something that will generate quality jobs for the future, not a band-aid casino project that will be an eyesore in just a few short years. Two, the rest of that industrial space should be a tech park where we encourage robotics and logistics-focused companies to set up shop in South Jersey City. Lord knows that we have enough abandoned warehouse space. We need technological challenges led by us, similar to the DARPA challenges that are quickly making self-driving cars a reality. I propose that our first challenge should be for $1 million to build a robot that can fill potholes on its own. And we should challenge every top university and engineering school in the country to build it right here in Hudson County, manufacturing in Hudson County. For jobs to come back, we need to lead the world in something other than tax abatements and politicians for hire. If you on the council call yourselves Democrats, and if you call yourselves progressives or conservationists, you would stand up to this mayor and tell him, no casino. And lastly, I want to speak about the violence in Jersey City. It seems as if there's a shooting every couple days out here, yet the mayor scolds those who speak up on the violence because, as he claims, other cities in New Jersey have it worse. Over the past few months, I have spoken with multiple law enforcement officials, including those in the leadership, and here are the facts. The Fulop administration sends out rookies for a couple of months during the summers in a show of force. These rookies are being deployed randomly throughout the district, so there's coverage everywhere. They're not deployed where the crime is the worst, and they're not deployed as crime moves around the city. They're simply scattered throughout the district. This is what someone does when they want the people to feel safe, not what you do if you want to solve the problem of violence and crime. Put simply, Steve Fulop is sending the most ineffective police officers in the most ineffective way to maximize a public relations play. And this is not just my view. Police detectives have voiced the same concern to me. No wonder the violence isn't getting better. Steve Fulop is more interested in making Jersey City look safe than actually making it safe. So I ask this council to call for revisions to the rookie deployment program to include experienced officers and to require deployments to areas that show up on the crime heat map. And lastly, I am calling once more on the city council to pass an ordinance requiring the mayor once per month to tour himself on foot the most crime-ridden ward in the city to see the havoc his policies are creating in the inner city neighborhoods. Jersey City deserves someone who will fight for everyone, not just a propagandist who's in bed with casino developers. Thank you.
Christine Barisi, McGinley Square, not here. Sasha Arunarate, Arunarotney. Arunarotney.
Yes,
perfect. Got it. Karuna Ratney.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Sasha Karuna Ratney. I'm the program coordinator for NPower's Technology Service Corps. Our nonprofit organization partnered with JP Morgan and Mayor Phillip in their investment in workforce development in Jersey City. And as a result, we are proud to announce that we are launching our Technology Service Corps program at New Jersey City University. Our program is targeted towards youth, underserved youth between the ages of 18 to 24. We focus on workforce development and we provide free IT training for those young adults. We would greatly appreciate if the council would assist us in spreading the word to Jersey City's respective wards. And also, I have program flyers available here if you could please advise me on the best method of distributing those flyers.
We'd love to. And lo and behold, we are investing in technology and training for Jersey City's
wonderful
youth and population. Wow, great news. Thank you for sharing that with
us. Thank you very much for your time.
Now, here we thought from others that we weren't doing anything about that.
How's that working out? All right. Betsy Dobson. Betsy Dobson here. Betsy Dobson. Coming once, twice. Gus Dobson.
Good afternoon. My name is Gus Dobson. I own the house 13 Wigman Court, Jersey City. Actually, I bought it from the city 32 years ago. Okay. And at my house there, I have nowhere to park because he brought that fence all the way up to my house. The fence actually is against the wall over there. When I bought the house, they said the garage is what with the house, which wasn't true. Okay. When I got it from the auction. Now I have a fire hydrant, I have a light pole, I have a cable, now I got a sign saying no parking in front of my house. Each of them is only about 3 feet apart. So I can't even park close to my house. I have to park almost at the golf field if I find a place. Okay? And I've been paying taxes to that house for 32 years. Okay? And I think it's wrong. The fire hydrant, the light pole, the cable, are now a sign that the gentleman put up there. And I don't think it's right. Okay, no one can park there. I have neighbors next to me. We don't have a driveway. We cannot park. So the signs are no parking. He took 25 feet away from me. So I have to park, try to park in front of someone else's house if we can find a parking place. So I don't think it's right. And I think something has to be done about it. Because all my life, I've been giving donations to the city and to the police department and the fire department every time they write to me. And my name is always there with a check, okay? And I don't think it's right what we have down there, you know? And this guy has have to stop. The truck, the big truck we were talking about, he parked in the middle of the street. It stayed there for like a month. Mr. McCain came down and made him move it. Give him tickets, okay? That's an old truck from Central Laundry, so you know how old that truck is, from the west side. And it's not right, and I hope here tonight we'll get some kind of consolation out of this. All right? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
He don't have nothing on that. He did. Well, the city came down and saw it down there. He got, it's got to be 100 years old. I'm going to say something. That family is using old dealer plates that is not legal, okay? His son and him, I said it and I meant to say. He used dealer plates, phony plates, the McCann, been down there, he saw it, okay? So the cars is not legal because he was trying to put a parking lot down there. So it's not right. And this is right up to my house. I'm the dead end, right to the fence. The line comes 6 inches away from my house. Okay? So, I thank you very much.
Christine Allen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. First of all, I want to start by thanking Mayor Phillip and the City Council men and women for allowing me to speak to you today about something that's very close to my heart. I want to talk to you today. I want to break down in tears already. I want to talk to you today about a disease that steals your memories, that robs you of your relationships, that takes away your ability to take care of yourself, and makes even the familiar seem odd and scary. I want to talk to you today about Alzheimer's disease. In the next 30 years, Alzheimer's disease is going to increase over 600% in our Hispanic and our urban communities alone. Right here in Hudson County, we actually have over 6,000 residents who are currently battling the disease. But the scary thing is that half of them don't even know they have it. The other half have received no support, no education, and no treatment. My name is Christine Allen, and I'm the president of Act Now Foundation. We're a 501c3 nonprofit organization dedicated to raising awareness and educating our underserved urban communities about Alzheimer's disease. But I'm here today to tell you that Act Now Foundation is launching a very important project. It's called the Alzheimer's Resource Center of New Jersey, and it's the first resource center in all of northern New Jersey. And we've chosen Hudson County to open, and we've actually chosen the city of Jersey City for our headquarters. And I have to say thanks to Councilman Daniel Rivera for that, because it was actually his idea that we open the resource center here in Jersey City. So I'm inviting all of you tonight to our grand opening ribbon-cutting ceremony that's taking place on November 12th. Mayor Phillip will be there to officiate the ribbon cutting, and of course Councilman Daniel Rivera will be there to say a few words on our behalf. But this center is going to be the first step many members of our urban communities take towards a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. We will offer free memory screenings, support groups, educational workshops for our caregivers, and resources to help them get through the progression of this disease. We are all about increasing and improving the quality of life for our Alzheimer's patients in Hudson County, as well as their caregivers. So the grand opening is November 12th. We are opening up here on Newark Avenue, right across the street from the Brennan Courthouse, located at 586 Newark Avenue on the second floor. The Visiting Homemaker Service of Hudson County was actually kind enough to donate their space to us. So we're very excited. You should have already received a packet of information with a press release and information about the event, but I have some others here that I'd like to give to you, and I hope that we see you, all of you there. Seven? Okay. So that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. That's good. I'm a nonprofit. I have to save every penny I have.
Thank you so much for.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. I really appreciate all your support. You've been fabulous. Thank you. Well, they are working on new medication. You know, the medication that we have does not treat the disease. It only treats the symptoms and can slow down the progression, which is why we advocate for early diagnosis, because it can help for the patient to remain cognitively alert. But yeah, they have some promising new drugs in the future. We're hopeful. We're all going to need it. Thank you.
Quentin Buse. Quentin Buse. Carlos Rodriguez. Hats back. Jason Berg. Hats off in the room, Jason.
Welcome back.
Hats off in the room, Jason.
Don't be so shy. Maybe
hats off in the room, Jason. Hats off. Hats off.
Oh, why is that? Excuse me. Why?
Hats off in the room.
Excuse me. Is it a law?
Wearing a hat?
I can wear it.
Just proper.
Well, proper for what?
If you want to be improper.
Okay, let's begin. It's 5 minutes.
Jason, weren't you in the military?
Yes.
You're on just 5 minutes, Danny.
He's on the clock. Let's go.
I'm under arms. It's very strange. Sometimes I've had worn my hat and... Oh, yes, I have. You must be blind. You must have suffered from Alzheimer's disease. Thank you so much.
Oh, gosh.
That's all right. It's my time to play with. I haven't been here. I'm sorry. I've been off doing other things. It's amazing. On March 24th, I was at the U.S. courthouse in Newark, New Jersey, doing some work with National Reliance as one of their coordinators with one of our members. And at a certain time, at 1:30 a.m., p.m., excuse me, I was jumped by security officers for suspicious activity. And they never told me what the suspicious activity was. Yeah, it must have been that. It was cold out that day. And I asked the police officers, or the former police officers, known as security guards, there's 5,000 of them in U.S. courthouse system, what was the problem? What laws have I violated constitutionally, code-wise, state-wise, for statutes and ordinances? They wouldn't answer me. Now, when such an individual asks a person of supposed authority to do something, and they do not respond, that person has the right to leave. When that person deconsents to the authority and power that is supposedly in front of him, which he is part of one of the people, and is jumped, it's a violation by the individual. So I'm having my fine time in court in December. But the irony here is that when police officers who swear to abide by the Constitution start to enforce statute law, they're in violation of the Constitution and their oath. There's an interesting website called the United States of America Department of Travel. It's usadot-gov.org. And it isn't there rulings about traveling, like the U.S. Supreme Court rules confirms constitutional right to travel. Duties of government officials. And in there, there is something called the penalty of law. It's 18, it's USC Title 42, 1986. The action to neglect to prevent in states. Every person, man, having knowledge of any wrongdoings conspired to do and having the power to prevent or preventing neglects or refuses to do so shall be liable for party injury. And that's one of the things that they did to me. Now, courts are to protect the constitutional rights. It is a duty of the court to recognize the substance of things and not the mere form. The courts are here bound to by more form, nor for they are misled by misform pretenses. They are the liberty. Indeed, they are under the solemn duty to look in the substance of things. Meanwhile, they are entered upon and inquire upon. The legislature has transcended the limits of its authority. If therefore the statute polluted to be entitled to protect, the public safety has no real or substantial relation to those objects or parable envisions of the rights secured by the fundamental law. It is the duty of the courts to adjourn and thereby give effect to the Constitution. Now, the restrictions of power. Police, private corporate state, municipal policy enforcement officers, aka police officers, and limitation of power, nothing is gained in the argument of calling it police power, and this is the city. And in this article, it says that when you go outside the law of the statutes, you are personally responsible. Policemen are not, do not have surety bonds. Only judges do. And when they do something illegally, they are personally responsible. Because a corporation may not, the corporate city seal of the Jersey City, if you see right here, it says corporate seal, you can't see that, can only actually work in contracts. So when you go to court, make sure you go to that website, United States of America, Department of Travel, and find it. And take care, take heed, be aware, because everything is up to you folks. Liberty is at stake. Thank you all, I'm so glad to be back.
Daniel Sicardi.
Oh, great.
What's
Daniel
name?
Sicardi. Next would be Josh Feinstein. Is Josh Feinstein here? Pardon me? We respectfully acknowledge and appreciate it. Mr. Sicardi, you do not get this time. Begin.
Okay. The first thing I want to do is say thank you, Mr. Byrne, for letting me speak, because I called in very late. Then I want to mention one of the council people that's been posting a lot of historic pictures on the web. I really appreciate that, and he's currently out of the council chambers, but I'm sure that somebody is going to give notice to him that I appreciate the postings that he's doing. Okay, I have three issues that I want to talk on, and I'm going to be very quick and very specific. First one has to deal with City Bike and the City Bike installation that occurred at the intersection of Westside Avenue and Kensington Avenue on the northeastern corner. Originally, City Bike installed a bike station on the block that St. Al's Church and School is. And they made a big stink. That is, the parishioners from St. Al's, and they said, you can't have that here. So it was moved across the street to the intersection of Kensington Avenue and Westside Avenue. Now, you, I see you scratching your head, but I just want you to know that Danny's prepared now, okay? I've got 189 signatures already in regards to people that are upset over this. And it doesn't really impact me because I have two parking spaces in front of my house. But here's the deal. What the first thing I did was I saw it before they completed the install, and I contacted Joe D'Souza because I saw where they were painting it out. And I said, Joe, what's going on here? It's less than 10 feet from the crosswalk, which is illegal and against the law. And not only that, it is in a posted no parking zone. All right? I don't have to have people show their hands because that would be very disrespectful. Everybody knows what happens if you take a car and you park it in a no parking zone. You're not allowed to do it. And you're also not allowed to utilize that space for anything else. Because a no parking zone is placed in after approval from the state and county. And you have to contact both of those entities before you can have a no parking zone removed. You got me? So it's not legal for it to be there. Now there's a man who works as the intermediary between City Bike and the city of Jersey City, and his name is Carlucci. I contacted him, and I contacted Joe D'Souza. And Joe D'Souza was told by City Bike that it was going to be 15 feet away from the crosswalk. I posted pictures after I took a measurement, and it's 9'6", and I don't want to admit, you know, basically anybody who wants it can take a look at it. It's illegal, you still have the no parking zone, and let's move on to the next issue, okay? A lot of people are talking about a guy who put up a fence. Everybody here is a paid political municipal employee. You guys are supposed to know the ordinances as it relates to putting up a fence on personal property better than me. You also are completely aware, and legal is right here too, and they know that you are required to have a setback before you can post the fence, as is determined under the ordinance. So if you have a fence that is at the beginning of your property line, it's illegal and it has to come down. And you can be fined and given a citation for every day that that fence remains in the location that it is. So if you have a 50 by 50 block and you have your fence on that, that's cool. But you have to have a setback to enable people to walk up and down and cross over, like the sidewalk. Even if you don't have a paved sidewalk area, you have to have that setback. Legal, look it up. It's covered in the ordinance, and you can do that. Now, the third thing is, I have enough time. Okay, and I'm sorry. Let me catch my breath, because this one's going to be easy, too. I have an R1 residential home. I pay taxes on an R1 residential home. I'm not going to mention anything about historic tonight, but I am going to mention something very slightly about Airbnb. If I had a motel or a hotel, and I was doing business in JC, I'd be paying a hell of a lot more than 6% in taxes, and I'd also have an awful lot more oversight than these people from Airbnb are going to try to get by. And if, for any reason, the city council contemplates doing that, I expect to have my property taxes adjusted, because every time you screw around with my zoning protections, it impacts what I pay for in my R1 zoning qualification. Thank you.
He's coming.
Hey, if you're going to speak next, you are Nathan Cody, Stephanie Miller, and Sherwin Vaughn. Please migrate up to the front row.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
I just have one question. It's the Wegman Court thing. You said that you were going to get in touch with that homeowner. Just a question. In the event that the city does a survey on the property and nothing can be built on it, is it possible that eminent domain can be taken over so the city can do something better for that area?
I have to defer to our law department and planning folks. I don't know the answer to that.
Oh, okay. So that was my question, because the bottom line is they say that there's two properties on either side of this block, but in the event that you can't develop on it, so
right.
If they just did something, that's it. That was my question. That was all I needed to
believe,
know.
I believe that's what Joanne indicated.
Yeah.
When she was giving her, she didn't use the word eminent domain, but I believe that's what she was indicating when she said acquire. Joanne, if worse came to worse with the Wegman Court and all the more amicable ways of solving the issue don't work out, is eminent domain at our disposal as an option? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I needed.
Just to be clear, sir, that would be a lengthy process, I would assume, correct? That would be lengthy, I would assume. It would take some time.
Yes.
Yeah.
We are waiting for a survey of the property. The owner's attorney says...
No, domain. Yes. No, I'm saying I was reacting to Rich telling me it would take 2 days.
Yeah, I'm sorry. And that's after the city takes a survey themselves, correct?
Well, we would look at his survey first. The survey is supposed to be prepared by an independent licensed surveyor / engineer. So,
turn it on the bottom.
Surveys are prepared by they're licensed by the state of New Jersey. It's a course of study that they undertake. So if it's actually a survey by a licensed surveyor, we can confirm the accuracy of it, but in all likelihood it will be correct. And then it's a matter of having engineering go out and plot, or perhaps even that surveyor to go out and physically plot where the lines are so that we're very clear on what is his property and what is in the public right-of-way. And then if we determine that the turnaround is insufficient or that there is some other municipal public purpose to be served by acquiring the property, then we will have to negotiate with him to do that. hopefully voluntarily, without eminent domain, but worst case is eminent domain, and then we would argue about value after the fact.
Right, because I'm just saying there's, you can't develop on it. The soil is too soft for them to develop. Well, no buildings, anything, so.
Well, I mean, that might affect the value of the property if it requires some extraordinary support in order to build, or if it's unbuildable totally, then that would affect the value.
That's what I'm thinking, because you can't build on it.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Nathan Cody.
How you doing?
Hi.
Yeah, I heard my sister.
Better?
Yes, much better. Yeah, I heard my sister talk about my mother, 84 years old, living on the block. I heard my neighbor talk about how many violations of the law are being broken on Wayman Court. I heard that young man with the yellow shirt right there said there's no fire hydrant. Call the fire department and tell them there's water on the block. My mother said living on the block as we speak. If she dies tonight, what I'm supposed to come out tomorrow and say, almost had the water on the block? Huh? The gas truck come down in the mall and they turn over. Could they go down there and dump the gas? It's nowhere to turn. What am I going to do? I called the feds. Me, Nathan Cody, called the feds. I asked for a federal investigation because the son's a cop, the other one worked for the state, and they got a fence in the street. I'm 50 years old. I've never seen this before. Then you're going to sit here and tell my sisters and these people that they own the block, the middle of the street. They call you, you have to put a right away, a fence up. Every lot need a fence and a lot. We know that. In Jersey City, there's 100 lots ain't got no fences up. 100 of them. But he put a lot in the street, not on the side of the abandoned building where the law requires one to go. He put it actually in the middle of the street. Like you might well say, he put it exactly in the middle of the street, but he did it in the end because it's a dead end block. But y'all think this is nothing but, you know, y'all. I'm telling y'all right now, my mother is on that block and it's dangerous. I've been coming down here for 30 days, 37 days, I'm telling y'all, it is dangerous. I lived here for 37 years, and nobody doing nothing. Just some, oh yeah, we knew the fence, I've been there, I walked down the other day, I seen it. But your mother's sleeping good tonight. Am I right? No answer. But I'm going to tell you this right here though, this is the day. This ain't no dread. I know y'all bigger than I'm bigger. Trust me, I'm 50 now, I'm bigger and I'm better than that today. But this is a fact. Nobody's subject not to be arrested for a citizen. A citizen is arrested by anybody. And tomorrow I'm going to make press charges against the mayor, me, Nathan Cody, because you know the violation on that block, and I'm going to try and find it. So you have to tell them a citizen is coming. Because my mother ain't dying for nothing. For nothing. For no fence. On the middle of the block, it's not a wall, it's just a fence. She ain't never been down there, don't live there. It's dangerous as heck down there, already. And you're gonna put something in the middle of the block, and you're gonna, we can still wait till the fence comes down, till the law comes around, and then change. But it's too late. I don't call the feds to ask for some help. Y'all ain't doing nothing. Y'all say, yeah, you went down the block, but you did nothing, and you're still doing nothing. Oh, it's bad, you're looking into it. But something could happen tonight, right now, as we speak. And the fire truck, I go down there and get the fire truck and say, this is unsanitary. I went down myself with the whole fire truck. He said, this is not right. This is not right. But it's still there. The day the 14th. The day the 14th. And it's still there. My mother is in the house right now. And that damn fence is still there. Excuse my French. It's still there. Y'all just sitting here. I've been out here 30-some days taking time out, just coming out and get this fence up, because I know one day my sister gonna call, he did the other night, scared the hell out of me. But I'm telling you, you need to do something better than this. We put our trust in y'all, and y'all know better than this. Y'all live in Jersey City, no offense, no going, no street. You don't put a son nobody, no story. Tell me it's right away, it's right here to block the lock. You're looking like a fool sitting there talking to me like that. It's in the middle of the street, not on the side of the block. Excuse me. You're not blocking the property. It's not his property. I lived there for 37 years. It's not his property. Nobody got the right to buy a street. See what I'm saying? Tell him that he owns it. You got to hire a lawyer that he can tell me he don't own it. And then you say you're sorry. And this could have been in Zoom a long time ago because it's in the middle of the street. A It's not on the side of a lot, abandoned building. You don't sell nobody. After your mama built that house, you're going to turn around and tell me you sold that man the right of way without saying that the other 16 people live on the block? If it did, all of you need to go to jail because that's just the law. I've been a lawbreaker all my life, mostly. I know breaking the law of people. I know a thief when I see one, and I know wrong. And this is wrong. This is more wrong than anything. This is more wrong than anything. God bless.
Stephanie Miller.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
I am another resident from Wakeman Court. I am a homeowner, and I have lived on this block for over 34, going on 35 years. My concern is, like the rest of my neighbors, the safety with this gate being at the end of this block. It wouldn't be so much maybe impassioned if the gate didn't block the center of the block. But we can't get any emergency vehicles down the block. They can't turn. What if an ambulance comes down, fire trucks, the police? I have a video on my phone of the medical transport that Jason uses with them trying to do a K-turn in the middle of the street, who just barely was able to pull it out because the space was empty. We've had several cars damaged, with cars backing up, with the garbage trucks, with the street sweeper. Just as was said, our block is tight, but we all are pretty good drivers on that block. We know how to handle it. However, the other individuals who come down and try to turn in the driveways, they do cause damage to our property as well as to the other vehicles. And I also have a concern for the children with the vehicles trying to back down the block. We have a few kids who like to play and ride bikes in the street, and it is a concern why they're playing. These vehicles are backing up. And I have a question. If you're going to put up a gate, shouldn't there be some kind of safety barrier, a guard, rather than a gate? You know what I mean, because anybody, God forbid, can pass out and just plow the gate down, but shouldn't there be something to protect them from going over the cliff? Because a gate really won't do it, at least not in my thought. Like was said earlier, we have several individuals on our block who need medical transport. We have Jason Dabney, Mrs. Waiters, Mrs. Crutchers. We have Mrs. Cody, Mr. and Mrs. Vaughn. They may be able to utilize it at one time, but they're going to be penalized because of this gate. I'm hoping that all of the impassioned words that was said here today aren't falling on deaf ears, and that something will actually be done to resolve this situation and help return our block back to the way it used to be. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our last speaker, Sherwin Vaughn.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
My name is Sherwin Vaughn. I'm a resident of the block in question, and I came here a little late. But we are aware that there's four different lots, correct?
Excuse me, sir?
Are we aware that there's four different lots at the end of the block? It's not one lot, it's four different lots.
Okay.
I heard the city attorney talk about they got in touch with one of the owners. Is that correct? One. What about the other three? Okay.
And I was told he erected them on the other lots with the consent of the owners. I don't know if that's true.
Okay. Were they notified?
I don't know.
Okay. Could they be notified?
Yeah.
Because they, perhaps, they would, you know, remedy the situation. Maybe it's just the one person that you spoke to.
You speak to the council.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Perhaps if we spoke to all of them, we could remedy some of the situation at the end of the block. But by only speaking to one person, if he's not in favor of it, you know, there probably could be no remedy.
Okay.
But
point well taken.
Yeah. Excuse me?
I said point well taken, sir. Your point is well taken, and we'll make sure that all of the parties that are involved in the area there need to be probably notified and brought into the...
And how soon can that be done?
They're in the process of making these communications, but we'll double check on all of this. They're currently in the process of communicating, as was said. I'm not sure when you arrived, but they're communicating with the attorney for the property owners and make sure that they're communicating with all of the property owners that would be involved in this. And as I said, I will reach out to the one property owner that I'm aware of, but I'm not aware of the other, if there are other, who the other property owners might be.
Thank you.
Thank you,
okay.
Sir. Council members, that is it for the speakers list. We'll do the petitions and communications. I know we have to do other business. Items 6A through 6Z12. We have officers' communications 7A through E. Reported directors 8A. Council President, do you want to do that other item now?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me get myself together here.
So this would be...
Make a motion to remove 11H and 11I from the tabled agenda for consideration for final adoption.
Second.
Thank you for the motion, Council
President. Yes.
Seconded. By Councilperson Osborne.
Yeah.
I'll read them into the record after the motion. Councilperson Gajewski?
Aye.
Ramchal is absent. Bagiano?
Aye.
Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera? Waterman?
Aye.
Lavara?
Aye.
Okay, let me read them into the record. 11H, City Ordinance 15104. 11H from our tabled agenda. 11H, you all have copies. City Ordinance 15104 is an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 12, Authorities, Municipal, Article 2, Incinerator Authority of the Jersey City Municipal Code, dissolving the Jersey City Incinerator Authority, and amending and supplementing Chapter 3, Administration of Government, Article 9, Department of Public Works of the Jersey City Municipal Code, to consolidate and assume the functions of the Jersey City Incinerator Authority with the Jersey City Department of Public Works. This ordinance was introduced by the Council on July 15, 2015. In the intervening period, before its public hearing on August 19, 2005, or after August 19, 2005, when we held the public hearing, August 19, 2015, the public hearing was conducted and closed because it had to go before the New Jersey. Time for me to shut up. Yeah. After the August 19, 2015 meeting, at which the public hearing was conducted and closed, the city administration presented this plan in Trenton, New Jersey, to the local finance board. And the local finance board looked favorably on the dissolution of the Jersey City Incinerator Authority. Council members, there is a request by the city administrator. You all have a copy of this item. It's marked 11H on your copy, and it was in the packet you received today. City business administrator is proposing to strike the last, remove the last paragraph on page one. Remove the last paragraph on page one.
There's no later than months.
Right. We're going. Right. And we're going to go to the page 6. Under section 3, you'll see a blank where it says this ordinance shall take effect. Page 6, Article 3, Roman numeral 3. We're going to, in this ordinance shall take effect no earlier than January 1, 2016, subject to approval of civil service concerning titles and permanent status requests from the city. Someone care to offer that language in the form of a motion to amend?
Second.
Did I hear Councilperson Osborne make that motion?
I'll take the motion.
I'll take the second.
I wrote it already.
All right.
I wrote the motion to the lady, and I'll give you the second.
Yes.
Thank you, Council President. So, Councilperson Osborne made the motion, seconded by Councilperson Lavaro to amend. On the amendments now, just the amendments, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Bajano.
No.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Lavaro.
Aye.
The amendment has been approved 6-1, Councilman.
Robert, can I ask something?
1 second, sir. Councilperson Bajano voting no on the amendment. Yes, Councilman.
You're reintroducing this tonight.
Not reintroducing, sir.
Well, you're bringing it back tonight. Was anybody from the JCIA notified that this was going on? Because I look out, I don't see anybody here who would like to have spoken about this.
The public hearing was conducted
right. And
closed.
But do they know it's been reintroduced tonight? I mean, I'm sure they would have been here to talk about it. And I got to say this. I see the DPW, they fooled around with that with the parking authority into the police department. We merged the police and fire department, and I haven't seen any improvements in anything. It's like, and here we're going to go messing around with these people's lives. We're going to do away with the incinerator authority, and nothing's going to change. It's just going to be another cluster. It's a shame.
Hey.
Okay, call for the votes.
To do that? Councilperson Gajewski for final adoption as amended.
Aye.
Bajano.
No. And I think it's a shame what they're doing.
Osborne.
Another campaign promise filled. Aye.
That's why. Coleman. That's why everything's messed up. Campaign promises.
Coleman.
I think it's reducing the expenses by combining the two departments together, and I vote aye.
Rivera? Waterman?
Aye.
Council President?
Yeah, just this is another campaign promise, as Council President Osborne said. We said we would consolidate the incinerator authority with the Department of Public Works. I vote aye.
Councilman Bajano voting no. We have a 6-1 vote for the final adoption of city ordinance. Page 15, 104. That will be given the.
We'll have to agree to disagree.
That'll be given the identification of 4D on our agenda today. Council members, the motion also was to remove item 11I, City Ordinance 15-125, an ordinance of the City of Jersey City in the County of Hudson, New Jersey, amending Ordinance Number 10-085. Of the city finally adopted July 14, 2010,
providing for the acquisition by the city of real property in the city and construction of various improvements thereto, and appropriating $7,700,000 therefor, and providing for the issuance of $7,333,300 in general improvement bonds or notes of the city of Jersey City to finance same. This ordinance was introduced on September 9th, 2015. A public hearing was conducted and closed on September 24th, 2015. This would be known as item 4E this evening.
4D?
4E.
I'm sure you have written on it 4D, as in 4E. David.
4E. We had 4D was the incinerator. Okay, so we're calling for the final adoption of City Ordinance 15-125. Councilperson Gajewski?
Aye.
Councilperson Maggiano?
Aye.
Councilperson Yun is absent. Councilperson Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Councilperson Rivera? Councilperson Waterman? Council President?
Aye.
Adopted by a 7-0 vote, City Ordinance 15-125. We'll get the identifier as 4E on this meeting. Council members, we are to the claims and addendum number one. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Maggiano. Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera? Waterman?
Aye.
Lavara?
Aye.
Approval of the claims and addendum number one. 10A through 10L resolutions. Yes. 7-0. We have a 7-0 vote for the final adoption of City Ordinance 15-125. You're welcome.
Roll call.
10A through 10L, Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Maggiano.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman. Lavara.
Aye.
7-0 for A through L. M through U. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Maggiano.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera, Waterman, Lavara.
Just on M, I know Councilman Ramshaw would want me to let everyone know that on Saturday, October 17th, having the Best Side Festival on West Side, north of Communipaw, going to Belmont. Come on out, it's going to be a great time. It's the Best Side Festival as Councilman Ramshaw works to improve the West Side community. I vote aye.
M through U, 7-0. Council members Ramshaw and Yun absent. B through Z5. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Maggiano.
Aye.
Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera. Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara.
We're just on 10Z. Councilwoman Coleman and Joyce, you were on the committee too? And Danny as well? Thank you for your hard work on that, as well as everyone else who worked on that, in putting together the recommendations and the report and the strategic plan on the disparity study. As was promised previously, the committee has delivered. I urge everyone to take a look at that. I vote aye.
Thank you, Council President.
Sure.
Out on the railing still. Take one out. We're on the railing. Z7 through 13, Z6 was withdrawn, so it's 7 through 13. Councilperson Gajewski?
Aye.
Bargiano? Osborne?
Aye.
Coleman?
Aye.
Rivera? Waterman?
Aye.
Lavara?
Aye.
Everything is 7-0 except in Z9, 6-0-1. Councilperson Rivera abstaining. 14 through 22, we have a late scratch of Z19 and Z20. They need a repair. You'll see these resolutions at the next meeting in a different form. So Z19 and 20 are withdrawn. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Bargiano.
Aye. It's about time the elevator was fixed at the
fire. Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman.
Aye.
Lavara.
Aye.
We have a 7-0 vote for the approval of 10Z14 through 22, the balance of business. Z23 through Z28. Councilperson Gajewski.
Aye.
Bargiano. Osborne.
Aye.
Coleman.
Aye.
Rivera.
Aye.
Waterman. Lavara.
Aye.
We have a 7-0 vote to approve. And I have a motion to adjourn at 8:17 by Councilperson Waterman. Who made the second?
Everybody.
No.
Candace.
Councilperson Osborne. To adjourn at 8:17, we have Council Members Ramchal and Yun absent by acclamation at 8:17.
Diane, are you going to deliver the community awareness series? Are you delivering the community awareness?